go back to the beginning, 1965, at the time that Expo 67 became an idea in the Canadian mind, I was with the United States Information Agency as one of their design directors. One of my first jobs was to select architects and interior designers working together at the very outset. We came up with the combination of Buckminster Fuller and the Cambridge Seven.
The form, the three-quarter sphere, this great envelope coming to the ground in that way, was developed by Cambridge Seven. From then on, Buckminster Fuller and his group developed the details of how that enormous three-quarter dome was to be accomplished. That's what happened.
We were very fortunate to work in collaboration with Buckminster Fuller and his associates in making the exhibit structure an integral part of the project from the very first day.
And then, of course, one of the great achievements was to get the trains going right through the building.
Large enough to take the whole of Lever House and place it in there and it wouldn't touch anything.
The thing we wanted to do was to celebrate the space itself in the design. And one way was to create this inner landscape of terraced platforms.
The whole idea of having a three-dimensional environment, like a series of lily pads in depth, was a natural solution to that incredible volume of space. So inevitably, things had to be big, they had to be strong, they had to be capable of standing on their own two feet.
Conceptually, we really began with the idea of a one-way route through space, starting at the bottom, working upwards with a dramatic long ride on an escalator to the top, and then a trip downwards from platform to platform, which was really a linear sequence of exposure to some very dramatic exhibits.
The flow of humanity through that pavilion really energized it. People became the exhibit in a way.
I think Cambridge Seven really were very intelligent to come up with a kind of Piranesi feeling of people moving in all directions.
To ride those escalators was a most beautiful experience, because at that point you could stand still while your eye changed its position and floated vertically as well as horizontally through this changing perspective. It had a wonderful dreamlike quality, really, to go through that space. Transparent, diaphanous, beautiful surface at the whole of the expo grounds all around you. And one saw tens of thousands of people.
I used to love watching people coming onto the moon platform. And we had the lunar landscape, the lunar landing vehicle, and all the other wonderful hardware that had been generated by the space program.
We wanted everything to be real, so that you could feel the sense of that capsule returning through the upper atmosphere, see that burning bottom of Apollo.
But to sit in the astronauts' couch was a big thing for them. You know, that was contact. They were really part of it.
We started with the idea of Creative America and fleshed it out by having lots of discussions with Cambridge Seven.
Well, we got some terrible letters at the beginning from congressmen who were upset because we didn't show our weapons or our industry. But everybody knows the U.S. is a strong industrial nation. We didn't have to tell people that.
We tried to show the other side, the tender side, the creative side, the improvisation, the experimentation, all those things that create what America really is.
For the first time, we were able to go to artists and say to them, what would you do if you had unlimited space
Do you want to do a 100-foot high painting? Love it.
Another overriding consideration that governed everything we showed at Expo was that it ought to be quintessentially American, which is why we picked Hollywood.
Oh, there's that thing that Debbie Reynolds was in. It's the pure nostalgia of Hollywood, you know, was there. And they began to recognize their favorite old movies, and they melted at that. How wonderful that a great big country like the United States can turn a whimsical cheek to the world.
We combined our space program with Raggedy Ann dolls. We had mousetraps and we had modern art. We had the American cinema, all as expressions of the diverse creativity of Americans. And the main advantage of the World's Fair situation is that there is no need, in fact, the opposite is really required, to develop any given subject in depth. It's by its very nature more superficial, more impressionistic, more playful.
It was just the sense of being there. It was that sense of the spirit of it and the overall feeling and view of it that was the most memorable thing.
The difference between day and night was phenomenal. The quality of light, this kind of glitter and overall lighting that was created.
It was an excitement that I have to say I've never seen since or before. And I've done a lot of exhibitions that I've been proud of, but I've never been so affected by a space as I have by the interior of the U.S. Pavilion.